Well, good evening. Welcome to Maundy Thursday Worship. We come to you from multiple households this evening. This is, of course, the Leitsky Kitchen. We also come from Louise Williams, from Tsuping Chang Wong, and from Janet Wade. We're all worshiping in our homes because we're under stay-at-home orders, and so that's what we're doing. We are worshiping in our home and doing this alongside you. There are some things you can do to be ready if you aren't ready already. A tablecloth, if you want one, we'll be removing it later. A candle, if you want one, we'll be removing it later. A pitcher of water, warm water preferably, a basin, and a towel for foot washing. Those are the things you'll need. If you don't have those in handy and you want them, go ahead and get those now. Maundy Thursday is the first of the 3 days, special days that aren't like any other in the church here. We're still technically in Lent, but we've kind of left Lent. We're in this space that isn't quite Lent, isn't quite Easter, isn't quite anything. Yes, time is still passing, life is still going on, we still have to do all our normal stuff, but this is something different and special. And we'll hear more about that as we go ahead here. But Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and the Vigil of Easter are kind of their own thing, their own worship service. And so we begin our worship service here in the Leitsky home. Friends in Christ, in this Lenten season, we have heard our Lord's call to struggle against sin, death, and the devil, all that keeps us from loving God and each other. This is the struggle to which we were called at baptism. Within the community of the church, God never wearies of forgiving sin and giving the peace of reconciliation. On this night, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor, and enter the celebration of the great 3 days, reconciled with God and with one another.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, source of all love, on the night of his betrayal, Jesus gave us a new commandment to love one another as he loves us. Write this commandment in our hearts and give us the will to serve others as he was servant of all, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. The word of the Lord. A reading from 1 Corinthians. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The word of the Lord.
A reading from John 13. Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for that is what I am. But if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who has sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed. You are blessed if you do them. Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me. And as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The word of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. A few minutes ago, Pastor Tim indicated we are at a liturgical threshold, a time when we leave something behind, Lent, and turn toward something new that's not quite here, Easter. Maybe you're noticing another threshold. We can feel it in the air, warmer days, greener grass, trees budding, flowers blooming. Here in the Northern Hemisphere, we are on the threshold, leaving winter behind and waiting for spring to fully arrive. I notice in this time of staying at home, many people are spending more time gardening or taking it up for the first time. They're doing what farmers have done generation after generation, pandemic or not. I remember it well from growing up on a farm in Missouri. Our lives depended on this springtime ritual, preparing the ground for spring planting. And I remember another ritual of spring. The cattle, after a long winter of eating dry hay, standing at the gate, the threshold, waiting to be turned into the new pasture, where they could feed on the green, tender, new growth. It's not unlike what happened in ancient days, about this time of year, when the shepherds prepared to move the flocks to the new pastures. They marked that movement with a celebration. At night, when the sheep were all bedded down, they threw a party. They roasted a lamb and danced in the light of the full moon. Now, we might feel disconnected from these rural roots of the celebration that came to be known as Passover. But most of us know well what it is like to be on the threshold, leaving something behind and waiting to enter the new pasture. Right now, perhaps some of us are grieving because we have to cancel or postpone or reconfigure some of the celebrations and rituals we have ordinarily used to mark those thresholds and transition times. Baptism, confirmation, graduation, weddings, birthdays, moving to a new home, retirement, promotions, even funerals all look different these days. We might even think of this whole time of COVID-19 as a kind of threshold, leaving behind life as we knew it just a month or two ago, and awaiting, maybe with anxiety or even some fear, the unknowns that are still to come. The Israelites in tonight's first lesson were on the threshold. They were longing to leave behind their life in slavery in Egypt, and head for a place of freedom in the promised land. Our lesson interrupts the flow of the narrative in Exodus. You'll have to tune in for the Easter Vigil to hear part of that exciting story on Saturday. But our lesson reads more like a page from the manual on the liturgy, with precise instructions on how the Passover meal was to be prepared and eaten, loins girded, sandals on, staff in hand. Sometimes we too are eager to make the move, and we have our traveling clothes on and our running shoes tied, ready to leave at a moment's notice. Other times we may be resistant and need to be carried, as they say, kicking and screaming, into the new pasture. Most often, though, there is some grief over what we leave behind, and there is some fear and anxiety, not knowing what the new pasture will be like, or maybe even where it is, or how many wildernesses we'll have to go through to get there. The only thing that makes it possible for us to wait at the gate, and then at the right time to venture across the threshold toward the new pasture, the only thing that makes us courageous to do that is to know whose hand guides us and whose love supports us. It really is that love that is front and center now. A love that delivered the Israelites from slavery to the new pasture of freedom. A love that is remembered and relived every year when Passover is celebrated, as it is these very days, by our Jewish siblings. And some of them are celebrating the way we are, virtually, over the internet or by telephone. It's a love that is unfolded before us in these 3 days, a love that Jesus knew well and shared fully with the one called Father. Chapter 13 in the Gospel of John is a threshold itself. What comes before is often called the Book of Signs. We sometimes call them miracles, from turning water into wine at the wedding of Cana to raising Lazarus from the dead. Signs pointing to, revealing bit by bit who God is and how God acts. All through the Book of Signs, we hear again and again that Jesus' hour has not yet come. Now, in chapter 13, we meet Jesus on the threshold, knowing that his hour has come to depart from this world and return to the Father. But before stepping across that threshold, Jesus spends some final hours with the disciples, and love fills the air. That love comes first as gift and then as command. Jesus, John tells us, loved his own and loved them to the end. Even with all the failings and foibles, the approaching betrayals, denials, desertions, Jesus loved the disciples then and us now to the end, to the final, it is finished, to the end that we with the whole world might live in that love. With that love, Jesus, the Good Shepherd, leads disciples of every time through uncertain thresholds to new pastures, not necessarily to some far-off adventuresome place, with new and exciting people. The new pasture is often right there in our own homes and with our own families and in our neighborhoods and with the people we meet at a safe distance or on the phone or over the internet. Its newness is not in place or people, but rather in how we can be with one another, beginning here and now. How we can love one another as Jesus loves us. How we can serve one another with self-giving love. to make it clear, Jesus demonstrates that love. Jesus knew that the disciples weren't going to understand it fully then. And even now, we who know the end of the story don't fully grasp it either. It's that radically different from any way of being we've known before. I've spent my whole adult life trying to understand this dramatic, surprising, radical act of Jesus washing disciples' feet. Like almost every story in John, this passage has multiple layers, and there are many insights and at least 1,000 sermons here. I've even taught semester-long courses on the topic. I invite our attention now to just one aspect and invite you to explore, meditate on, and discuss among yourselves all the other insights that might be there. Of all the disciples in the room that night, Peter must have had some inkling of what was happening. It's not right that you should wash my feet. I look up to you. You're the master. It's not right for you to be a servant to me. Peter understood the way service works. Some have more status, more power, more privilege, more wealth, and can command those with less to serve them, often relegating them to servant roles not of their own choosing. And even in the most benevolent circumstances, this kind of serving can become oppressive. Then there's the kind of service that is turned upside down. The one with the most reaches down to serve the one with less, like parent to child, teacher to student, professional to client. This way of serving, too, can easily become distorted by one's need to be needed, by an abuse of privilege and power, or by fostering a dependency where the other is never free. Jesus models a serving love that transcends status and power. Jesus gives a name to this new relationship later that evening. I no longer call you servants, but I call you friends, because everything that I have received from the Father, I'm passing on to you. This is the way Jesus loves, giving everything to friends, even laying down life itself, like the robe Jesus lays aside to wash feet. One of the thresholds on which Jesus stood that night before he was handed over to the authorities was to begin to hand over to the disciples the task of being signs, revealers of the God of love. Maybe Peter had an inkling that to let Jesus wash his feet was to be changed forever. I wonder if Peter had an inkling that to pass over into that new pasture meant that he could never see himself or anyone else the same way again. All the usual systems are subverted. There will be no more greatest among us, or no more sitting at Jesus' right or left hand. There will be no more me, me, me. There will only be us, friends, friends of Jesus, friends of one another. Maybe COVID-19 is beginning to teach us that too. The little people, the people who mop the hospital floors, the truck drivers, the folks who stock the grocery shelves, the telephone and cable guys, the unnoticed ones. We're learning how important they are, along with the medical professionals and others. Maybe we're coming to see each other as friends and asking how we can love one another as Jesus loves us. We are all in this together. In a little while, some of us will have an opportunity to practice that way of seeing and being with each other. The Leitsky family will generously model mutual foot washing for us. Some of us won't be able to wash feet this way because we live alone or for some other reason. We will need to be creative, to think of other ways to serve one another, making a phone call, giving to the food pantry, sewing masks, sending thanks to someone who serves us. We will all need to be creative in these days. Can you wash feet over a phone line or an internet connection? How do you love as Jesus loves from a safe distance? Unlike that first Passover, there's no rush here, no being dressed for travel. It involves taking off shoes and settling in, kneeling and taking time with another person, and doing as Jesus commands, washing one another's feet, loving one another as Jesus loves. Maybe by God's grace we experience, at least for a few minutes, that love of Jesus now in us, friend to friend, transcending all differences and divisions, putting aside any claim to status or power. And maybe by God's grace, in our serving and being served, God will be a little bit revealed. See how they love one another. At the end of the Maundy Thursday liturgy, we are left at that threshold. No benediction, no sending to serve the Lord. We usually strip the altar and remove everything from the chancel at church. Today, some of us will strip our dining room tables as a reminder of that. Now, perhaps more than ever, we are left without the usual symbols, trappings, or words, left on the threshold to remember and reflect on what happened long ago, what happens among us, and what is still to come. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
On this night, we've heard our Lord's commandment to love one another as he has loved us. We who receive God's love in Jesus Christ are called to love one another, to be servants to each other as Jesus became our servant. Our commitment to this loving service is signified in the washing of feet, following the example our Lord gave us on the night before his death. I invite you now to wash each other's feet as the Lightskis will do their best to wash each other's feet. Pour the water over her feet. Just pour it over her feet. We're try to get it in the buck in the bowl, but yeah. Yeah, Jane reminds me it's not a bucket, so I shouldn't call it that. The towel's for your mom. Jane needs help with the picture. Maybe mom can help her. Yeah. But we'll see if she needs help.
I do.
Yeah. How about if I pour?
Okay.
And then you can wash. I'm gonna come over on the side of you. Okay?
For the time. My feet are bigger than the bowl.
All right, can you wash Daddy's feet?
Yeah.
Hot water is better than cold water.
I always use cold water. It gets all the germs off, but I think it takes too much time to get the warm water going in the chocolate.
It doesn't take us too much time this time. Trust me, ice cold water on you when you aren't expecting it, not pleasant. You good? You good?
Love serves and willing
And normally, if we were at worship together at Trinity, this would be the stripping of the altar, when we would all be quiet, the choir would sing something, and the altar guild would strip the table. But we're not able to do that together, so we're going to strip our tables in our own home. We're going to do this as quietly as humanly possible. There will probably be some noise. And you can do this along with us. Shall we?